China does 4, Turkey does 7. So if we become, we start converting 4 times, just like China is today, in 15 years, and in 15 years our cotton production goes to 25 million bales, we could be having a value of $100 billion. But let's plan. We have a textile policy which was put in place, and when I left, it was abandoned. The textile guys are running for, you know, from pillar to post for gas. So I think we need to have a strategy and then follow that strategy, because these are long-term investments. People will just basically not invest in this country if we keep changing policies overnight. We also said that we need to have a bankruptcy law, the Corporate Restructuring Act. I had got it approved by the cabinet. All it had to be done, what had to be done, it had to go to all the ministries if they had any concerns, and present it in the parliament for approval. That was, ladies and gentlemen, January of 2010. It's still sitting there. We just cannot just basically move like this. And the plan was that after these, you know, the bankruptcy law, let's have a resolution trust funded by the government or guaranteed by the government, but run by the private sector, private equity firms, and we buy, you know, those assets which basically are not performing today, give it to the people who basically can do it better, so that we can really improve the productivity, competitiveness in our industrial area. Nothing will happen over here if we do not have proper infrastructure. And that means roads, that means farm to market roads, cold chains, support clusters like industrial, you know, kind of areas in different parts of the country, so that at least, you know, they get all the facilities. And that our requires, there is no reason why government should say that this is our responsibility. Across, you see, the border, India is using public-private partnerships. Sri Lanka has done it, Egypt has done it, where the private sector has become a partner. And what it does is that, the A, they provide the capital, B, they're efficient. So these projects are actually completed on time. When I was in the Ministry of Finance, I realized that for every 1 rupee we plan in the public sector, we end up spending 2 rupees, which means 100% cost overruns. At least you will save that, because these guys will have their own money on the block, so they will complete these projects on time. And we'll also get, you know, the capital. Moving on, we'll also need to just increase the depth of our capital markets. Today, you know, we have improved our banking. Since 1997, we had banking reforms. But guess what? The banking coverage of your banks in this country is 33% of GDP. That's the size of your banks. Bangladesh is 55. India is in excess of 65. And believe you me, Korea is 160% of GDP. We are lagging behind at 33%. We have to increase our banking coverage of this economy. But more importantly, we also have to establish debt markets. There are no debt markets. Thirdly, we got to link the capital markets, which is basically stock exchanges, back into the economy. There are few scripts, there are very heavy scripts, and they basically are running these stock markets. We think that the stock market is growing, but it's only 8, 10 or 15 companies which are growing, and, you know, their shareholders are prospering. Somehow or the other, we have to connect the stock markets into the real economy, which means more and more of these companies have to go to the stock market. We've got to give them the incentives that they should basically go over there. Then I'm just going to, you know, mention a very, very important element which no country has developed over a period of time without developing this, and that is the human capital development, education and health. I mean, no country I've seen, we basically have double-digit growth or, you know, sustainable growth without educated population and a healthy population. We only spend 3% of our GDP on education and health. Isn't it a shame? You know, Malaysia spends 11%, and some of the developed countries basically, you know, just spend more than 15%. So the target should be that we should increase this by 1% GDP every year, till we go to 8% in the next 5 years. So this cannot happen if we do not keep increasing our, you know, resource envelope. But this is a must. Lastly, the administrative and governance reforms. We are no longer, the government is no longer employer of choice in this country, like it was in the 60s or maybe the 70s. Nobody in the right mind would like to go to the government unless they are forced to or unless they believe there is nothing else. So we have to become an employer of choice, which means the three things we need to do: meritocracy, pay for performance and accountability. And I think these three things, unless we do not introduce them into our government, you know, functioning, you will not see, you know, a kind of, you know, administration will support this aggressive reform agenda. I think the audience will appreciate the events of the last few weeks as shaping especially volatile time in our politics, as we appear to be in election year. The transition mistakes of 2007 come to mind. Pakistan, with its current debt burden, energy crisis and falling social indicators, can afford even a day of inaction, let alone a whole year. It will be critical for all decision makers to keep the economy moving forward while the political dust settles wherever it does. A tough ask, no doubt, but certainly achievable with the right mindset and the right leadership. I would like to thank you all for this opportunity and wish ICAP and its esteemed members another remarkable 50 years, with the hope that at ICAP's centenary celebrations, Pakistan would have witnessed 50 solid years of growth, prosperity, and honest leadership. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tareem.